RNA viruses are recent, part one. We're going to be dealing with an article by E.C. Holmes on molecular clocks and the puzzle of RNA virus origins, published in the Journal of Virology in 2003. So it's actually been around for a little while, but I haven't seen anybody comment on it, and I think it's worth looking at. And we may have some of this intrude now and then. The computer can't sync, so I'm having to tell it to shut up. And this is kind of my summary of what the article says. Molecular clocks argue that viruses are recent. Standard phylogeny of evolutionary theory as to how the hosts of those viruses came about and the relationship between the viruses and the host argues that they are ancient. And the question is, how do you solve this puzzle? Now, I'm going to tell you that the background for this is also on the internet, and they say you can use it as long as it's for educational purposes and I don't make any money on it. So we will not take an offering. Although the ultimate origins of RNA viruses are uncertain, it seems reasonable to assume that these infectious agents have a long evolutionary history, appearing with or perhaps before the first cellular life forms. That's the expectation from the standard perspective. While the RNA viruses we see today may not date back quite this far, the evidence that some DNA viruses have evolved with their vertebrate hosts over many millions of years, and there's a reference there, makes an equally ancient history for RNA viruses a natural expectation. They expect the viruses to go way back. Yet a very different picture of RNA virus origins is painted if their gene sequences are compared. By using the best estimates for rates of evolutionary change, that is nucleotide substitution, and assuming an approximate molecular clock, which we'll look at in more detail, it can be inferred that the families of RNA viruses circulating today could only have appeared very recently, probably not more than 50,000 years ago. And if you look carefully, you'll discover that it's probably even less than that. Hence, if evolutionary rates are accurate and relatively constant, present-day RNA viruses may have originated more recently than our own species. Now, of course, this is assuming that our own species goes back several million years. Before discussing the solutions to this apparent paradox, it is important to determine exactly why the molecular clock estimates of RNA virus origins are so recent. The key to establishing a timescale of viral evolution lies in accurately determining the rate of nucleotide substitution. Most analyses undertaken to date suggest that the average rate of nucleotide substitution in RNA viruses is approximately 10 to the minus 3 substitutions per site per year, with an approximately fivefold range around this. Now, for the rest of this paragraph, the author will start by assuming that all substitutions are neutral in terms of survival, doesn't matter which way they happen, and then refine that assumption to include substitutions that are not completely neutral because they change a coded amino acid. One could extend his analysis to include sites that are important for RNA hairpin formation. The RNA has to match each other reverse, or binding from RNA to protein capsid elements. You want a particular arm to be out there and connect to the viral capsule. The fact that broadly similar rates are found in RNA viruses with very different genome organizations and lifestyles implies that both the error rate associated with RNA polymerase, estimated to be about one mutation per genome replication, that's a bit faster than per year, isn't it? And the rate of viral replication are roughly constant. If the average substitution rate of 10 to the minus 3 substitutions per site per year, that means in 1,000 nucleotide virus, it gets one substitution on the average. Then, on average, every nucleotide position will have fixed one substitution after approximately 1,000 years of evolution, corresponding to an average divergence time between two lineages of only 500 years. So it only lasts about 1,000 years before it has changed enough where you can tell which strain of virus you're dealing with. This also corresponds to an evolutionary corrected distance between two sequences of 1.0, the maximum that can be reliably estimated through sequence comparisons. Larger distances will be inherently inaccurate because of uncounted multiple substitutions at single sites. Of course, reality is a little more complex because viral genomes are a patchwork of synonymous sites where mutations do not change the encoded amino acid, and non-synonymous sites where mutations alter amino acids and which usually evolve more slowly. Because if you've got the wrong one, it can either be deleterious to the virus, it won't multiply as fast, or it can even outright kill it. If we conservatively assume that the substitution rate at non-synonymous sites is roughly 100-fold less than at the synonymous sites, at approximately 10 to the minus 5th substitutions per site per year, and we'll look at that figure from some other studies, then a distance d of 1 corresponds to a divergence time of about 50,000 years ago. Although the greater influence of natural selection at non-synonymous sites is likely to increase the variance around this. Hence, if two RNA viruses have an evolutionary distance of less than 1.0 at non-synonymous sites, as is the case for many viruses classified in the same family, and certainly for those within the same genus, then these viruses are unlikely to have diverged more than 50,000 years ago if these substitution rates are accurate. Now, what this means is that for unselected or weakly selected sites, after around 500 years, it is hard to be certain that two viruses are originally descended from the same virus. Or conversely, if two viruses look like they have descended from the same virus in their unselected sites, they probably split less than 500 years ago. For strongly selected sites, the number of years goes up. How much is a matter of research, and hopefully we'll be giving you some real-time numbers from real viruses such as influenza. As a practical example, to get back to the article, consider the genus flavivirus, for which the evolutionary relationships among member viruses have been examined in detail. The examples of flaviviruses are things like yellow fever and dengue. Phylogenetic trees of the flaviviruses contain three clades, corresponding to mosquito-borne viruses, tick-borne viruses, and viruses with no known vector. They just spread without having to have an arthropod in the way. If synonymous and non-synonymous distances are estimated among the representative members of these clades for the NS5 gene, and he has a computer program that he uses, full results, apparently if you email him, he'll give you all the details. I find that the average DS of the three groups is about 20 substitutions per site, indicating that synonymous sites are so saturated with substitutions that they cannot be reliably used to estimate evolutionary distances. Now, that's probably a little bit unfair because the 20 substitutions per site is obviously an estimate. Once you get past about one or two, it's pretty hard to be able to say anything about the substitution sites. However, the mean distance of non-synonymous sites of the three groups is roughly 100-fold less at approximately 0.2 substitutions per site, which would correspond to a divergence time of only about 10,000 years ago, assuming a non-synonymous rate of 10 to the minus 5 substitutions per site per year, which is, interestingly, not that much difference from 6,000 or 7,000 years, given the difficulty of making those estimations. even if the non-synonymous substitution rate is 10 times lower than this, so there, he's assuming pretty liberal, liberal assumption of how low it can go, the estimated divergence time would still only be 100,000 years ago. And to make the divergence of the flaviviruses correspond to the origin of placental mammals at 100 million years ago, which is where he'd like to go, would require a non-synonymous rate some 4 logs lower at 10 to the minus 9 substitutions per site per year. And to give you an idea of how accurate that is, that's what the human genome does with all of its editing enzymes and so forth. In other words, you'd need a really, really good replicase, which is obviously not the case. And to summarize that, I would say it takes assumptions that look ridiculous on the face of it to make the age of flaviviruses match the assumed standard age of mammals. Hence, simple molecular clock calculations suggest that the origin of RNA viruses is an extremely recent event. However, in some cases, such a recent origin conflicts with other evolutionary data. Perhaps the most notorious example is that of primate lentiviruses, which include the human immunodeficiency viruses type 1 and 2, that's HIV-1 and HIV-2, and a growing list of simian immunodeficiency viruses, also known as SIVs, that infect a wide variety of African monkeys. At face value, it would appear that these viruses have been associated with their host species for millions of years. Not only are they asymptomatic in their natural hosts, which, when compared to the high virulence of HIV, suggests that they have evolved stable associations over an extended time period, but the phylogenies of the viruses in the host often match, which means that the viruses in the host have undergone co-speciation. They've become species at the same time. Although the divergence times of the primate species in question are often uncertain, it is clear that virus host co-speciation must mean a viral evolutionary history dating back millions of years. In contrast, far more recent timings are revealed using the sort of molecular clock calculations described here. In this case, the maximum sequence divergence observed suggests that the deepest split among the primate lentiviruses occurred only a few thousand years ago. And nobody believes that, of course. And clearly far more recently than their host species diverged. A similar disparity between divergence times and phylogenetic history can be seen for another important human pathogen, hepatitis B virus. While not strictly an RNA virus, hepatitis B replicates using reverse transcriptase and so is also likely to evolve rapidly. Reverse transcriptase is not very accurate. Even though the precise estimates of substitution rates have proved difficult to obtain, close relatives of HBV, the hepadenoviruses, naturally infect a variety of species of non-human primates, including chimpanzees, gorillas, orangutans, and gibbons. They all have their own hepatitis B, so to speak. Although the phylogeny of these viruses does not match those of their host species, it is intriguing that these primate species are the most closely related to humans, which hints that they have evolved together over a period of about 20 million years. Moreover, the primates that harbor hepadenoviruses live in very different geographical locations, and it is difficult to see how these viruses could be so widely dispersed unless they had undergone co-speciation with their hosts, or were spread much more recently by humans. But did we really do it that badly to where we gave orangutans in Borneo and gorillas and chimpanzees in Africa the same virus? And that far back. However, as with primate lentiviruses, the best estimates of substitution rates suggest an evolutionary history of only a few thousand years. And hence, many orders of magnitude too recent for co-speciation. That is to say, lentiviruses, including HIV, are a good example of viruses whose molecular clock divergence of time is different from their evolutionary estimated times. So are the hepatitis B viruses, even though they are DNA viruses. That's because they are replicated by reverse transcriptase. Importantly, the discrepancy between phylogenetic evidence for long-term co-speciation and recent molecular clock dates is also seen for a number of single-stranded RNA viruses. There is some evidence that the phylogeny of isolates of GBVC, that is hepatitis G virus, that's a relatively new discovery, matches that of the human populations from which they are sampled, which means that Asian strains are different from African strains, are different from European strains, etc. If true, this would mean that the GBVC has spread with its human host over a period of 100,000 years or so. More strikingly, the closest relative of GBVC, the New World primate virus GBVA, has seemingly undergone co-speciation with its host species over a period of a few million years. However, if this ancient evolutionary history for GBVC is correct, then the overall substitution rate needs to be in the range of 10 to the minus 7 or 10 to the minus 8 substitutions per site per year, which is obviously not what it usually is, and therefore far lower than those usually documented for RNA viruses. Moreover, high substitution rates in GBVC, approximately 10 to the minus 4 substitutions per site per year, have also been observed in intra-host comparisons. A similar situation is apparent with New World hantavirus, family Bunyaviridae, and the arenaviruses, for which the host and virus trees have been compared in detail. In most cases, it seems that these viruses have undergone co-speciations with their myriad rodent host, that's a fancy word for mouse, over several million years, although there is also evidence for occasional cross-species transfers. Moreover, a history of co-speciation is not restricted to animal viruses and has been proposed for the plant tobamoviruses. Whatever the virus, the problem is the same. This is not isolated to one particular virus. It's all over the place. If the inferred history of long-term virus host co-speciation is correct, then the rates of nucleotide substitution in these viruses must be far lower than those reported for other RNA viruses. Otherwise, their gene sequences would be unrecognizably different, which means that hepatitis B virus, hantavirus, arenavirus, and tobamoviruses all share this phenomenon of rapid change when you look at them and slow change when you put them into an evolutionary scenario. In some cases, one even has experimental evidence as to how fast the virus mutates, and it matches experimental expectations for other viruses and not the presumed evolutionary history. Why do RNA viruses appear to have originated so recently? He's asking, they can't be that recent. Why do they look that way? So, at face value, there are three explanations for the apparent discrepancy between the very recent molecular clock estimates for RNA virus origins and the phylogenetic evidence for virus-host co-speciation over millions of years. The most obvious is that the molecular clock is not constant and that rates of nucleotide substitutions have changed dramatically both between viruses and along lineages. Of course, that's a non-uniformitarian assumption. Specifically, if some RNA viruses evolved much slower than others or have experienced periods when their rates of nucleotide substitution were reduced, then divergence times could be greatly extended. An important example of such a change in substitution rates is provided by influenza A virus. Although synonymous substitution rates in influenza A viruses from aquatic birds, horses, pigs, and humans vary no more than is usual among RNA viruses, the non-synonymous rate is greatly reduced for the avian viruses compared to that seen for human viruses. So maybe something is keeping it from evolving quite so rapidly in birds. This supports a model in which there has been a substantial rate acceleration coinciding with the species jump from birds, in which influenza virus persistently replicates in the gastrointestinal tract and is asymptomatic, to humans, in which it replicates in the respiratory tract, causes regular epidemics, and is subject to strong immune pressure. Similarly, the non-synonymous substitution rate is lower in the asymptomatic SIVs, simian immunodeficiency viruses, than in the pathologic HIVs, human immunodeficiency viruses. Whether such differences in non-synonymous substitution rates are typical of RNA viruses that experience fundamental change in their biology, persistence, tropism, and virulence, as they switch hosts, clearly requires further investigation. So that's an idea. Doesn't have any really good evidence for it, but you can explain it. Maybe the viruses do not mutate as fast as advertised in some hosts. So while it is clear that the non-synonymous rates can vary to some extent when viruses infect new hosts, other than the debated case of GBVC, there is little evidence that overall substitution rates, that is for synonymous and non-synonymous sites combined, are orders of magnitude lower than the 10 to the minus 3 substitutions per site per year, and hence sufficient to greatly extend viral divergence times. Indeed, the best evidence for low substitution rates is the supposed match between virus and host phylogenies, itself a subject of debate. Such lack of large-scale rate variation may not be unexpected. Because RNA polymerase has no repair activity, it is unlikely that intrinsic rates of mutation will vary substantially between RNA viruses or that they have been lower in the past than they are today. So, no, I don't think so. It is also unlikely that evolution could effectively grind to a halt if a virus reaches an adaptive peak, such as a stable association with a particular host species, so long as replication continues. It's got to be changing. Although the fixation rate of the advantageous mutations might drop dramatically if there are few ways to improve fitness, which is seemingly the case for avian influenza viruses, many synonymous sites would still be expected to be neutral and therefore to accumulate sequence changes. In other words, the non-synonymous sites might be frozen, but the synonymous sites should keep going on anyway. For example, although the rate of non-synonymous substitution is reduced in the asymptomatic SIVs, overall substitution rates, because the synonymous ones are the same, are very similar to those seen for HIV. Furthermore, a continued accumulation of amino acid changes throughout time has been observed in a variety of RNA viruses, and experimental studies have provided little evidence for stasis in RNA virus evolution. In fact, this seems to be the rule for biological systems as a whole. As a case in point, living fossils, like the coelacanth, have undergone very little morphological change over long periods of time, hundreds of millions of years in the standard view of things, suggesting that they are at an adaptive peak, but have similar rates of nucleotide substitution to other vertebrates. Evolution is occurring much more fast when you look at it, then it looks like it's happening in the fossil record. So perhaps the viruses do not mutate as fast as advertised in some hosts. Well, that's probably partly true, but not enough to completely or even mostly explain the phenomenon. So it's not a good explanation for everything. Perhaps the most likely way that clock rates could vary between RNA viruses is if there are major differences in rates of replication, that is, in virus generation times. For example, HIV and HBV both replicate using reverse transcriptase, but HBV undergoes many fewer replications per unit of time, which seems to have resulted in a lower substitution rate. Hence, if RNA viruses differ dramatically in replication rate or have experienced periods when replication was either latent or extremely slow, then this would reduce substitution rates in the long run and would correspondingly extend divergence times. There's at least one group of viruses, the human T-cell lymphotrophic virus types 1 and 2, HTLV 1 and 2, which were originally thought to be HIV, but were later realized to be a dead end, for which such a difference in replication rates has been demonstrated to have had a major effect in substitution rates. In epidemic situations where transmission rates are high, most notably in populations of injecting drug users, replication rates are rapid as the virus spreads quickly in each new host. This results in substitution rates similar to those seen for other RNA viruses. However, in regions of endemicity, where vertical transmission is common, that's from parent to offspring, usually from mother to offspring, HTLV 1 and 2 maintain themselves within hosts through the clonal expansion of infected cells rather than through active replication. In this case, the substitution rate is reduced to that of the human DNA polymerases, which is 10 to the minus 9 substitutions per site per year. You may remember that 10 to the minus 9 is about what you need to account for the standard evolutionary view of how far back things go. The overall substitution rates for HTLV 1 and 2 estimated to be 10 to the minus 6 substitutions per site per year, quite a bit lower than 10 to the minus 3, is therefore a composite of that very low and the short-term rates. Finally, some RNA viruses establish persistent infections within their host species, which is also likely to result in lower rates of replication. As such, persistence might be expected to greatly reduce substitution rates in the long run and also to increase the likelihood of virus host co-speciation, as is perhaps the case for the rodent hantaviruses. So, explanation for this may be HTLV 1 and 2 may be partly explained in this way. They don't mutate as fast as in some hosts as others, and reduced replication rates in hantaviruses may help here, but you notice it is not a general explanation. A second explanation for the recent origin of RNA viruses is that the methods currently used to estimate evolutionary distances from gene sequences are flawed in some way, leading to a substantial underestimation of divergence times. Excuse me. Although there are a number of factors that influence the accuracy of these methods, for example, the probability of different types of base changes and variation in base composition, the most likely source of error is in the relative rates of substitution for different sites along the sequence. If RNA viruses are biased such that substitution rates vary dramatically between sites, this could have a major effect on distance estimates. In other words, some sites mutate a lot and some sites don't mutate at all. So perhaps the viruses do not mutate as fast as advertised in some hosts at what we're doing, or maybe we're doing the math wrong because we haven't taken into account these slow, very slowly mutating sites. The development of methods that allow rates of nucleotide substitution to vary among sites has been one of the major advances in gene sequence analysis in recent years. And there's a recent article that goes over all those. The most commonly used method in this context utilizes a gamma distribution in which a sequence alignment is divided into a number of classes, each with a different substitution rate. The precise distribution of these rate classes is then described by a shape parameter denoted alpha. Low alpha values, that is less than 1, mean that the sequence alignment is composed of very quickly and very slowly evolving sites. And this appears to be true in most cases. Notice that that was alluded to earlier in the article when it talked about synonymous and non-synonymous. You have to divide at least into those classes and perhaps into more. Applications of the gamma model can greatly inflate evolutionary distances and hence have a radical effect on divergence times. So if we use the math this way, we can make things work. For example, an analysis of amino acid sequences from 57 proteins suggested that the divergence of eubacteria and eukaryotes only occurred about 2 billion years ago, with some 1.5 billion years more recent, or some 1.5 billion years more recently than suggested by the fossil record. Fossil record goes back 3.5 billion years. It's almost a factor of 2 of error in the estimate. While this could be taken to mean that cellular life has a much more recent origin than is usually thought, a reanalysis of the same data taking into account among site rate variation using the gamma distribution produced divergence times far closer to the 3.5 billion years than that was expected. Although a 1.5 billion year change in estimated divergence time is clearly a major effect, it is proportionately tiny compared to that required to reconcile molecular clock estimates of viral divergence times with those inferred under co-speciation. You see, that is a factor of 2. We're talking about a factor of 1,000 or more. Theoretically, however, it is possible to obtain ancient divergence times for RNA viruses simply by employing extremely skewed gamma distributions. The question is, are those real? Under this scenario, the vast majority of non-synonymous substitutions take place at a very limited number of sites, while the rest of the sequence evolves far more slowly. As an example, consider the evolutionary distances estimated for second codon positions from our representative sample of flaviviruses. It is currently not possible to estimate gamma distributions for non-synonymous sites alone, so second positions serve as a rough approximation. Virtually every second position that is changed gives you an entirely different amino acid, which is partially true for first and unusual for third. For the three groups of flaviviruses, the mean D at these sites, corrected for multiple substitutions but without a gamma distribution, is 0.25, more or less, and is similar to the non-synonymous distance estimated previously. Not much change there, which we already saw didn't give you what you needed. The maximum likelihood estimate for the state parameter of the gamma distribution for these data is highly skewed. Alpha is 0.34. As expected, evolutionary distances increased if they are now estimated using this gamma model, with the mean D being approximately 0.43. although not sufficiently to make a major difference to estimated divergence times, which only increased to a little over 20,000 years. Excuse me. Again, assuming a rate of 10 to the minus 5 substitutions per site per year. However, more dramatic results are obtained if an even more skewed gamma distribution is used. If alpha is 0.1, remember we were talking about 0.25 and stuff like that, then D increases to 2.3 so that the maximum divergence time will be in the range of 100,000 years ago. Likewise, if alpha equals 0.05, half of that, that equates to a mean distance of 52 substitutions per second codon site with a maximum divergence time of 2.5 million years ago. So we're starting to get into the range. We're still not into the 20 million range, but we're getting closer. Although the numbers are now so large that the distances cannot be considered accurate and the variation in distance among sites will be enormous. Similar observations have been made with respect to primate lentiviruses. So maybe we're doing the math wrong. Well, not really. Or at least not wrong enough to really explain what we're trying to get at. An extreme bias in the rates of nucleotide substitution among sites can therefore have a dramatic effect on estimated divergence times. Could RNA viruses evolve in a way that among site variation occurred in such a biased manner? Is this real? There are reasons for thinking that such a scenario is realistic. RNA viruses clearly differ from other organisms in their remarkable capacity to mutate. An important evolutionary byproduct of these high mutation rates is a cap on genome size. Genomes larger than about 15 kilobases are rarely produced because of the error threshold, the generation of prohibitive number of deleterious mutations. And in case you're wondering about that, that is basically saying that at a certain point, genetic entropy takes over and the organism can't keep going. Since viral genome sizes are limited, sequence regions will encode multiple functions, and individual mutations will often have pleiotropic effects. That means one mutation will have several different effects, such as those influencing both cell tropism and immune invasion. This, in turn, may mean that there are relatively few evolutionary pathways that can be followed by RNA viruses. They have to be all more or less the same, because if they deviate too far, they'll get killed, or they won't multiply. Otherwise, at least one key function will be disrupted so that mutations preferentially accumulate at the small proportion of sites that are free to vary. Supportive evidence for such a model is the frequency with which convergent evolution is observed for RNA viruses. As expected, if only a limited number of evolutionary pathways are viable, and the evidence that RNA and protein secondary structure can act as constraints against sequence change. The virus has to be so good in order to simply survive. The problem, of course, is that the alpha values estimated using the analytical methods available at present are a long way from the extremely biased values required to produce such ancient divergent times. The evidence doesn't support it. Whether these methods are systematically underestimating the extent among site rate bias in RNA viruses remains to be seen. That is, doesn't look like we're really doing enough with this to explain the problem. The math isn't that badly off. The final explanation for the recent origin of RNA viruses is that this is, in fact, what happened. The key to this hypothesis is that the molecular clock dates discussed throughout this paper only relate to the RNA viruses currently circulating, that is, those that have been identified over the last 100 years or so. Thus, RNA virus families like the flaviviruses may, in fact, have histories dating back many millions of years, but the early members of these families have gone extinct to be replaced by those we sampled today. So maybe the viruses have been inherited, and the divergence times that we see are the divergence times, but there were other divergence times, and all the viral lines except for one died out, and then that one gives us our 500 years that we're expecting. All that is left following these extinction events are the very long branches relating to the different families of RNA viruses to each other. Although the absence of a fossil record for RNA viruses means that it is difficult to test this hypothesis directly, it is striking that comparisons of viruses from different families reveal extreme sequence divergence, such as they are often no more similar than random sequences would be. In which case, how do you know they're even related? Indeed, the tree of all RNA viruses is highly distinctive in that it is composed of relatively close tips representing members of each viral family connected by internal branches of generally unquantifiable length. That's describing an orchard rather than a tree. In these circumstances, it is impossible to accurately infer when different families of RNA viruses diverged. As such, the lineages leading to the RNA virus families we see today could have existed for many millions of years, but the early history has been erased by a combination of multiple substitution and continual extinction. Obviously, one implicit assumption in this model is that RNA viruses experience high rates of lineage birth, speciation, and death, or extinction. Although unproven, the rapidity with which RNA viruses evolve within single populations make it possible that they experience equally rapid macroevolution. Now, besides the other explanations, maybe the intermediates went extinct and we're being fooled into using an erroneous molecular clock, and that's why it looks so recent. The recent origin of RNA viruses depicted by molecular clocks is not therefore not as constraining as it seems. However, one major problem remains. How can we explain the match between virus and host phylogenies that is taken as evidence for co-speciation over millions of years? In some cases, most notably the primate lentiviruses, a wider sampling, that's HIV and company, a wider sampling of viruses has found so many exceptions to the strict match between host and virus trees that the validity of co-speciation has been questioned. Maybe they're not that old. Further, it is striking that for many other RNA viruses for which there is evidence for co-speciation, including GBVA and GBVC, arenaviruses, and hantaviruses, just to give you a few examples, there are also clear examples of cross-species transmission. If these viruses evolve at the same rate as other RNA viruses, then a process other than co-speciation must have produced the remaining match between the virus and host trees. So maybe they're not co-speciation, and two mechanisms seem most likely. First, if phylogenetically related host species tend to live sympatrically, that is to say they live near each other, then viruses will tend to jump between closely related host species, which appears to be the case for the hantaviruses. It will jump from one mouse species to another. If this process occurs at sufficient frequency, then the host and virus trees may often match, giving a false impression of co-speciation. Second, the ability to jump species boundaries may be dependent on the phylogenetic distances between hosts, so that it is easier to establish a new infection in a closely related host species than in a more distantly related one. That is to say, it may be easier for a virus that's very good at infecting, let's say, ducks to go to geese than for it to go to parrots, and even harder to go to humans. This model has at least has a veneer of biological reality, as it is evident that as host gene sequences diverge, especially the cellular receptors to which viruses bind, the less likely it is that an invading virus will be able to infect a foreign cell type and establish a productive infection. Unfortunately, while both models are possible, they currently lack clear empirical support. Nice theory, no evidence to back it up. So, well, it's probably not just that the intermediates went extinct and we're being fooled. At least there is no empirical support. So what needs to be done? As this review has highlighted, there's currently no all-encompassing explanation for why the molecular clock dates of RNA viruses' origins are so recent, at least if one assumes the evolutionary timescale. However, it is possible to identify areas where future research might be expected to clarify the situation. First, it is obviously important to obtain more accurate estimates of substitution rates in a wide variety of RNA viruses. This can be most profitably achieved by examining viruses sampled over an extended time period, although such data can be difficult to collect. If RNA virus evolution is universally rapid, then we would expect to see a steady accumulation of mutations within the time frame of human observation. Conversely, viruses that pick up no or very few mutations during the sampling period would provide compelling evidence for slow clock rates. In the same way, it is clearly important to obtain better estimates of rates of viral replication in nature. Excuse me. In this context, it is particularly important to determine whether persistent infections in viruses with low replication rates are also associated with low substitution rates, as this is perhaps the most likely way in which the molecular clock could differ between viruses. Indeed, it is possible that whether a virus causes an acute or persistent infection represents a major division in the life history strategy of viruses, and that substitution rates might also vary accordingly. So, the question we should ask and try to answer is, how fast really is the molecular clock? Okay, second, more studies of RNA virus evolution in animal and plant populations are required. If examples can be found of long-term virus host co-speciation without the exceptions that are visible with current data, then it will be difficult not to conclude that the viruses in question have an ancient evolutionary history. In turn, if the sequences of these viruses are not excessively divergent, that is, D is less than one at non-synonymous sites, then this would also constitute powerful evidence for a low rate of nucleotide substitution. Likewise, examining the extent to which non-synonymous substitution rates change when viruses infect new host species is central to understanding the forces that affect the tick of RNA virus clocks. So we want to know not only how fast is a molecular clock, but we want to know, is co-speciation real? And if so, how common is it? Finally, it is clear that we need new models of sequence evolution that incorporate the idiosyncrasies of RNA virus evolution. There are a number of areas where improvements could be made. First, more sophisticated models of non-synonymous evolution are required, specifically those that allow a limited number of sites to accumulate the vast majority of changes, as may be true of viruses in nature, as well as those that take account of RNA and protein secondary structure. At present, most attention has been directed toward gamma distribution, but it is possible that this model is too simplistic for the realities of RNA virus evolution and that more complex statistical models are required. It might also be necessary to develop models that allow patterns and rates of non-synonymous evolution to differ among lineages. Although this will clearly add to the complexity of models, it may represent an important step toward reality. If you've got to be more complex to be more real, then maybe that's what we need to do. In the case of primate lentiviruses, amino acid residues that are highly variable in HIV are sometimes conserved in chimpanzee SIV, and this may have a significant effect on dating estimates. Such lineage-specific differences in rate might be incorporated using the so-called covariation model of sequence change, which has a long history in molecular evolution and is currently experiencing a newfound popularity. More radically, it might also be possible to develop epistatic models of sequence evolution in which mutations that occur in one sequence region affect variability elsewhere in the genome. So now we're talking some really complex math. These models have some precedent in evolutionary genetics, for example, in the guise of fluctuating neutral space, and may be a powerful innovation given the potential importance of compensatory changes in viral evolution. Although these developments are technically complex, they may greatly assist our attempts to accurately reconstruct the origin of RNA viruses. So we're not only going to look at how fast is the molecular clock, and is co-speciation real, and if so, how common? The other question we want to answer is how complex are the molecular clock issues? Now, that's the end of his paper. My take on that, there's one hypothesis that has not been considered, namely that the virus molecular clock ages are roughly accurate with the refinements that are necessary, and that the ages for mammalian divergence, et cetera, are not real, and that all ages have to be estimated from extrapolation of modern data rather than from geologic time and assumed ancestral divergence. That is to say, maybe they're not that old. How could one test this hypothesis? Well, as we look at changes in viral genomes, we should expect to find the current estimates for rates of change to be broadly confirmed. That is, the molecular clock in viruses is in fact accurate, more or less. Again, hold on for just a minute. Secondly, as we looked at changes in the genomes in larger organisms, we should expect to see more rapid changes than expected from the standard model within a biblical kind, documented experimentally. For example, all African green monkeys would have come from one original pair, and therefore they would have diverged something like 5,000 years ago, or 4,300, or whatever the number is, rather than 14 million years ago, which would make them pretty much match. Between biblical kinds, the genetic distances between, let's say, cats and dogs, or between armadillos and kangaroos, should be variable, but probably larger than anticipated. The molecular clock should be reliable in the case of microorganisms. It should be experimentally faster than predicted by evolutionary assumptions in closely related larger organisms, and it should be largely useless in less closely related larger organisms. So when you see molecular people saying, oh, molecular clock is no good, well, it may not be good for certain things, while being very good for other things. And next week, we'll take a look at some of the evidence. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. We have one person who's actually read the paper, at least.
I didn't read it all. I'm just curious. When they establish it's 10 to the minus 3, is this by direct observation of comparing the DNA sequences over time?
That's my understanding, although we'll... I do know that in one paper it is, definitely. In some other papers it may or may not be, but that's one of the things we're going to look at, is how do they know that it mutates that fast? And in some cases they actually have sequences that they've taken for, in particular influenza A, where they have taken the virus and replicated it and then measured the, you know, basically done PCR, and then seeing what kind of RNA you have in the virus, and, you know, does it change from one point to another? And the answer is yes, it does. So that some of that is at least real. The thing I find fascinating is they're trying to explain 20 million when if they just stop at 5,000, they'd be fine. But, of course, nobody believes 5,000.
Well, this is a little bit like mitochondrial Eve.
It is. It's a lot like mitochondrial Eve and Y chromosome Adam to boot.
I'm not that familiar with Adam.
Well, the Y chromosomes are passed down from father to son. Don't go through the daughters at all. You know, if you have a mutation rate, you can calculate how far back there was an original one Y chromosome that accounts for all the men in the world.
Yeah, okay.
And those numbers, interestingly, are usually calculated using evolutionary assumptions. If you don't use those assumptions, why the rate turns out to be reminiscent of mitochondrial Eve. Mm-hmm. I think mitochondrial Eve was 6,500 years ago.
Yeah.
But of course, nobody believes that.
It sure stirred up a lot of discussion. As to how you're going to explain it.
It's kind of fun to sit back and watch them squirm.
I would say to this picture here, you can add to me. There isn't that much data out there that points to 6,000 years.
Well, this does point to a few thousand, though. I think that's fair to say.
A few thousand, yes, there is. I would say that the fact that recorded history, well, writing is so recent. History seems to be so recent in terms of major parameters. This is strange. If man has been around for 200,000 years, that's a conservative figure. maybe a million for Homo, genus Homo. There's so little evidence of this ancient man, and so much of it is so recent.
Well, you see, the dogs ate the homework, you understand.
We have, pyramids, we got aqueducts and all this stuff. Man does stuff. We've got here in the West, Southwest, even we some of these ancient buildings left by the Indians, very respectable structures and so on.
Yeah, Machu Picchu, the Nazca lines.
You go and down further, you don't find that solid evidence of writing, for instance. That's also very recent.
Yeah. Now, one can make a good case for the idea that that everything originated about 3,500 years ago, more or less. 3,500 BC, more or less. One can make a really good case for that.
And you can, and I would add to that the rate of reproduction of humans. We're reproducing at a tremendous rate. We're doubling, it depends on which. It varies so much, but no matter what figure you use, it's still tremendously fast at present compared to what you have to have for. Why did man sit around here for, let's say, 300,000 years and not decide to reproduce rapidly till the last. Well, you can say certainly the last 10,000, that's a conservative figure, maybe 5,000 years. All of a sudden, man starts filling the earth at a very rapid rate and didn't do it before for the first 99% of that time.
Yeah. It's the currently accepted population for humans in the world was around 10,000 people for a million or 2 million years or something like that, depending on where you draw the line between humans and non-humans.
I just... after seeing this, and I think it was discussed some time ago, that eventually, especially with the microscopic, the RNA and all the DNA and everything that they're discovering, that eventually evolutionists are going to have to cry uncle and say, and kind of give in or something. And
yeah.
I was leaning toward that possibility, but after today, I'm thinking that regardless of what they find, there's always, we need, at the very least, more study needs to be done. Or it's out there somewhere, and there are multiple creative explanations for why it doesn't fit their model. So I'm just not convinced that they're ever going to give up. I mean, some individuals, yes, they'll come to realize the truth, but
yeah,
evolution as a whole,
Sanford
I don't think
falls
it's,
in that group.
I don't think
but
it's
you're right
good.
That for a lot of people, it's the evolutionary story is more important than any piece of evidence. Than any combination of pieces of evidence, and that there's no way of breaking through, because we haven't tried this and we haven't tried that and we have maybe it's the explanation is over here, and even though you can hear him saying but it isn't really a good explanation, but we haven't run it into the ground yet, so we're going to keep going on it.
I hate to draw the analogy between science and what has been going on the last 2 weeks. I think it tells us a little bit about how flexible the human mind is.
Well, in that particular case, as long as you can point at the other guys, why your guy is okay. You know? And, one of the candidates talked about, he could shoot somebody on Fifth Avenue with hundreds of witnesses, and his core still wouldn't desert him. What can I say? People don't necessarily make up their minds in terms of the facts. There's also the question of, you know, what one's agenda is. And, I mean, you've seen somebody who is clearly not, clearly would not be able to be cleared for top secret information because of the abuse. And it's reasonably likely that person will wind up being president and be in charge of all that information. So it's like, it doesn't matter. The judgments that people make are not based on science, even if they think they are sometimes.
Even if they're scientists.
Even if they're scientists.
Just a couple of things. First one is, any journal you read, the famous words at the end is, more studies need to be done. It's all over. The other one...
One thing to keep in mind is that more research needs to be done means that you need to fund it, and you need to pick the best people to do it. And guess what? I'm one of the best people.
That's fine. you're in the review... what's the word? You're in the inner circle, so if you don't, then you're... That one, I forget the text, what the Lord says. Just before the coming of the Lord, it's going to be like the way it is to be during Noah's time. Mm-hmm. And don't we see it now? I mean, I guess many of us have been watching the last 2 weeks, and you shake your head. why does it come?
Yeah.
You know, how far more is it going to be that the Lord is going to wait?
Comment in the back here.
We were visiting with a friend this summer, and he summed it up in one word, and that one word was authority. The world today, at every level, from childhood through people have a problem with authority.
Well, and sometimes so, rightly so, because some authorities have abused their power pretty badly. Mm-hmm. And that raises the question is, which authority should you be believing?
Well, and the devil's biggest ploy is to make God look bad.
Yeah.
And so, you know, as long as people have a wrong picture of God, why would they want to submit to the authority of the Bible in any way?
Yeah. Well, the major reason I brought up this whole article is because the mythos out there, the general story that's being, the narrative that's being pushed is that, you know, creationists are some backward people with no evidence mm-hmm. whatsoever. Well, you look at this stuff, and it looks like it. You know, you could solve all the problems if you just, you know, made the divergence to be quite a bit less than what is normally assumed. You know, all of a sudden that you expand it to 10 to the fifth instead of to 10 to the third, well, that's pretty easy to do. Instead of going all the way to 10 to the ninth where you're, what, four orders of magnitude off? You know? Like I say, it's not a proof, but it does suggest that you're not an idiot if you believe in a short time frame.
Right.
It comes right back to the fact that whatever your paradigm is, that's what you're going to believe. You're going to accept what fits with that paradigm, and it's not a matter of fact. It's not a matter of evidence. It's a matter of belief system, and that, I think, is sad when they will point a finger and say that we have no evidence, that we have no scientists that are worth mentioning. We do. We have evidence that is incontrovertible in the Bible. They won't accept that. That's to their damnation. And that's sad. That's not what we want. We don't want them damned. We don't want them going to hell. We want to help them. But there's no way they're going to accept it. It's just like before the flood. Exactly.
Well, to be fair, I think some of them may actually listen to reason.
Yes.
That has happened in a couple of cases that I can think of. Probably the most famous one is that of Dean Kenyon, who at one time was one of the probably three or four authorities in the question of the origin of life. And one of his students came and just simply asked him questions and then just took the answers and then walked out. But he was an honest enough person to say, you know, that wasn't a very good answer. And that one wasn't a very good answer. And pretty soon, it occurred to him that the whole bunch really wasn't very good answers. And he was fortunately more committed to the truth than he was to the narrative. And he decided that that life on Earth just simply couldn't have come about without some kind of intelligence.
And I think until they're dead, they're not set. You know, the decision hasn't been made. So we should keep praying for them.
That's right.
Listen to them.
And we should treat them kindly, too, because you don't know what you're dealing with.
Right. And if you're rude and perish the fact.
Right.
But some of us are. And if we're rude and ornery, we don't portray Christ. We don't bring people to something better.
That's exactly right. Comment way in the back.
Assume the Bible timeline is true, and we look at viruses. Do they do anything good? My question, good meaning they're advantageous for life, or are they detrimental?
That's an interesting question because, you know, the viruses that live in birds don't seem, the flu viruses that live in birds don't seem to bother them at all. Now, is that just that it's so mild that it's not bad, or do they actually do something for the bird?
Or are they just a reservoir for using against other organisms?
Yeah, is the bird a particularly useful reservoir for nasty things that one can throw at people? I don't know.
The question is, what's the origin of the viruses? Did God really create these, or are these the works of the devil?
You know, that's a question that I intend to ask sometime in the first 1,000 years. But I don't know that we have enough data to be able to say at this point. You know, they could be commensals that are normal and just are bad when they get outside of where they belong. On the other hand, they could be that could be one way of keeping them alive so that you can periodically. You know, it's interesting because Fred Hoyle, after he realized that there must be some super intellect monkeying with the physics, proposed that there was somebody out there that periodically sent life down to Earth, and that it, among other things, it sent influenza viruses down. He may not have been that far off. I don't know.
Yeah, well, yes.
It's possible. And we may discover that that those viruses are particularly useful for the birds, and if they don't have them, I don't know, they get constipated or something. Anyway, next week we're going to look at some of the evidence behind all those assertions, and we'll see how strong this guy's case really is. And some of which is mentioned by him, some of which I did a partial citation index on this article to see who uses it and in what ways, and some of which, as far as I know, doesn't cite him at all, but that is still relevant, including an article we've seen before on flu viruses that has interesting divisions of mutations into non-synonymous and synonymous. So you get an idea of exactly how fast those non-synonymous ones actually happen in the case of flu. So anyway, we are still peering through a glass darkly, but we're going to do the best we can to clean off a little bit of the smoke.